Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents Spying on the Reich, The Cold War Against Hitler, by R.T. Howard, read by Julian Elfer. A note on sources. Documentary sources for the pre-war period are highly fragmentary. Many secret French and German archives were lost or destroyed, sometimes deliberately, during the Second World War. Nor did the French governments of the Third Republic keep official records of their discussions. Although since 1916, British governments have kept records that are usually released to the public after 30 years, SIS reports remain closed to the public. This book has attempted to piece together some of the surviving fragments and the clues to and glimpses of this secret world that emerge from public records and published memoirs. I have an instinctive mistrust of diplomats who want to convey the impression of being well-informed, of rumours that are manipulated by private agendas, and of fake news spun out by Goebbels' press service. A piece of information from a trustworthy source, and with value, can be distorted by the time foreign embassies get hold of it and put it onto a secret telegram. Paul Stehlin, French Air Attaché, Berlin, 1936-9. Many intelligence reports in war are contradictory, even more are false and most are uncertain. In short, most intelligence is false. Karl von Clausewitz, On War. Introduction. Early in the afternoon of the 1st of February 1939, a middle-aged man called Walter Friedrich Marat arrived at the Hebron Hotel in central Copenhagen. He showed the receptionist his passport to prove who he was, and then made his way, suitcase in hand, to his comfortable, although simple and sparse, single room on the top floor. To the hotel staff, there was nothing about this guest that seemed unusual, other than the fact that he had a noticeably strong German accent. Such visitors were always coming and going. His real name was Felix Waldemar Pütsch, and he was, in fact, a highly valued British intelligence agent who was tasked with obtaining vital information about what was happening inside Hitler's Reich. His spy handler, an Englishman he knew only as Karl, had provided him with a forged passport that allowed him to reach Danish shores and get through customs unchallenged. And it was Karl's substantial cash payment that would pay his expenses over the months ahead. In return, Karl wanted information about Hitler's Reich. And alone in his room, Pütsch looked out to the harbour, a few hundred yards before him, and across to the sea beyond, and began to draw up plans to obtain it. This was not the first time that the mysterious Englishman had helped him. Over the preceding year, Karl had enabled him to evade the clutches of the Belgian and Dutch governments. Both of these neutral countries had come under strong German pressure to crack down on the British and French spy rings that operated from this foreign soil against Germany. And in Holland, where the Nazi secret services had infiltrated British intelligence operations with stunning success, the Gestapo had also been hot on his heels until Karl had once again helped him keep one step ahead and slip unnoticed into Denmark. There was one simple reason why the British Secret Intelligence Service, SIS, was prepared to go to such lengths and to some expense to help Pütsch. The British government was desperately short of accurate, up-to-date information about the state of the German armed forces, and it was on this vital matter that this well-networked individual had something to offer. Born in Bad Schmiedeberg, near Wittenberg in Saxony, Pütsch had joined the German Navy in 1911 when he was just 18 and served on the cruiser Emden as a seaman. It was not long before he saw action, for within just months his ship had been ordered to suppress an uprising of native people in the Pacific Islands against German rule, a brief and bloody episode that was by all accounts marred by brutality on the part of the overlords. Later, in the First World War, he took part in pitched sea battles and skirmishes against the Royal Navy in the North Sea. But Pütsch had always had another interest besides seamanship. He had joined the left-wing Social Democratic Party when he was a teenager and subsequently became closely involved in its activities and those of some international Marxist groups in and around the port of Bremen. Before long, he had been appointed as one of the party's local representatives and by the early 1920s was helping to organize strikes, protests and demonstrations, as well as fighting street battles against a variety of political opponents, including Adolf Hitler's fast-growing National Socialist Party. Hitler's accession to power in early 1933 put the fear of God into Putsch, who soon fled his homeland, narrowly escaping arrest by crossing firstly into Holland and then, shortly afterwards, to Belgium. But he had no intention of giving up the fight against his political opponents. He immediately made contact with his fellow exiles, who were equally determined to rally domestic opposition to Hitler and to help other political exiles find places to live and work. And he kept in regular touch with his contacts in the German underground back home, sending them anti-Nazi leaflets and pamphlets that they could quietly distribute. But in early 1937, he fell out with his fellow exiles and was expelled from their governing committee. It was at this point that Putsch had become acquainted with a British official called Edward Kaiser, who was based at the British Passport Control Office, PCO, in Brussels. In Belgium, as elsewhere, the PCO provided a cover for British intelligence operations, and in this role, Kaiser was responsible for recruiting and running agents. Foreign intelligence services generally considered exiles to be a suspect source of information, but Kaiser was willing to take a chance. He introduced himself as Karl. Putsch never discovered his real name, and the two men soon struck up a good rapport. The German exile now became a full-time paid British agent, lured by a tempting amount of money and wanting to do something to undermine Hitler's regime. He had numerous contacts amongst his friends, family and comrades back in Germany who were in a position to tell him what he and Karl wanted to find out. He would write to them, using a series of post office boxes to make contact, and employing a similarly discreet method to pick up the anonymous and carefully worded letters they sent back. Soon he had cast light on some of the Reich's military secrets, including a number of technical developments the Germans had implemented, notably to the armor plate used by their new battleships. But Karl's most pressing priority was to obtain accurate and up-to-date information on the state of the German Navy, which the SIS had been instructed to make every endeavor to find out more about. Nearly 2 years before, in the summer of 1937, he had instructed Putsch to visit Denmark to investigate reports that the Germans were building ports and harbors on the island of Sylt in the North Sea, a capability that would have serious repercussions for the Royal Navy and for British security. Rumors had also long been flying about top-secret aviation experiments that the Nazis were supposedly carrying out in the area. But if Hitler's ships were dangerously below the radar, Denmark was a good place to find out more because, as the head of the SIS argued, it was, by its geographical position, very favorably situated for intelligence gathering on Germany. Now Karl had asked him to find out more about the specifications and capabilities of the German Navy, and to do so, on this second trip, Putsch planned to ingratiate himself with some of the German sailors who frequented the Danish ports. He would pose as a salesman, peddling hair tonic, to introduce himself and then buy them drinks and get them talking. Soon he had acquired detailed information about the movements of German vessels and knew exactly when they were due to arrive and depart so that he could appear at just the right moment. At the same time, he wrote cryptic, coded messages to his Bremen contacts and asked them for the information he needed. Felix Putsch was just one of many foot soldiers of a Cold War against the Third Reich in the years that preceded the Second World War, as their respective governments sought détente with Hitler, a settlement in Europe and a sense of stability, brokered by a policy of appeasement. This Cold War then continued from March 1939, when policymakers surrendered appeasement and instead made threats of war, until the German invasion of Poland on the 1st of September, when those threats were realized. This Cold War was not a campaign of covert destabilization, comparable to the efforts that the American government, for example, waged against the Cuban regime of Fidel Castro in the years that followed the revolution in Havana in 1959. It was instead an effort of intelligence gathering as a number of foreign governments scrambled to gauge the threat posed by a regime in Berlin that became increasingly belligerent and hostile, but remained highly opaque and unpredictable. This effort involved gathering accurate information about not just the Nazi regime's resources and capabilities, but also about the mindset and ambitions of its leaders and the attitudes of ordinary people upon whom even the most tyrannical regime is to some degree ultimately dependent. And although there were moments of relative cooperation between Berlin and some of its neighbouring governments, notably during the honeymoon period of the mid-1930s, when the Nazi authorities granted foreign access to some previously restricted installations and factories, this effort of espionage was always undertaken in an atmosphere of mutual suspicion and mistrust, and always at great personal risk to those who stood at its front line. The challenge of monitoring and assessing Nazi Germany was one that confronted the whole of Europe, which watched and listened to Hitler and his henchmen with growing alarm, and which worked hard to find out more about what was really happening within the borders of the Reich. Even neutral states such as Switzerland, Sweden, Holland, and Belgium could not afford to look away from a country that had committed sacrilege against Belgium's neutrality in 1914, when the German army had used its territory as a convenient gateway into France. European leaders were also well aware that the outbreak of another catastrophic conflict would create waves of refugees who would flood across their borders. Nor could more distant countries afford to look away. Despite its strictly isolationist approach in the 1930s, the United States government was deeply conscious of the seismic economic damage that another world war would inflict, particularly at a time of global depression, as well as of the strategic realignment that would then eventuate, especially at an hour when Washington might need comrades in arms against a communist Bolshevik order that had seized power in Russia in 1917. As the Secretary of State Henry L. Stimson argued in 1935, a great war anywhere in the world today will seriously affect all the nations, whether they go into that war or not. But while spying on the Reich was always an international effort, there were, of course, some countries that stood closer to the front line of the Cold War than others. At the very forefront were Czechoslovakia, Austria, and Romania. Hitler had openly described his ambitions to seize control over stretches of foreign territory where ethnic Germans lived, and he also had every reason to cast a rapacious eye upon the raw materials and infrastructure that these other countries could boast, but which the German economy, particularly its war machine, painfully lacked. Germany should start its racial fight, as the dictator once said, against those states which hosted oil fields, rubber, treasures of the earth. Romania's massive oil reserves represented a glittering prize, while Czechoslovakia's giant Skoda munitions plant at Pilsen was also firmly in Hitler's sights. He had outlined his plans in his 1925 autobiographical manifesto, Mein Kampf, as well as in his unpublished but revealing second book, written in 1928. But the two countries that mattered most in the Cold War against Hitler were Britain and France. This was not because they had more reason than any other to feel a sense of threat. On the contrary, the Führer consistently reiterated his peaceful intentions towards both countries, prompting some politicians of the time and historians of the present day to even question whether their involvement in the Second World War was ever necessary. Instead, Britain and France matter most in the story of foreign espionage against Germany because of their military and economic might. Stricken though both were by economic hardship and still traumatized by the experience of the First World War, only these two countries had the resources to take effective action against Germany. This was not necessarily military action, although the French possessed a mighty landed army and the British a formidable navy. Both could instead also have mounted an economic embargo, sanctioned by the League of Nations, the forerunner of the United Nations, that could conceivably have starved both the people and the economy of Germany. The Soviet Union was the only other European, or semi-European, country that could have posed a similar such threat to the Reich in the 1930s, but it was at this time too embroiled in its own internecine struggles, waged by a leader too focused on finding and executing his domestic enemies, real and imaginary, to mount an effective challenge. Joseph Stalin was bleeding his own country red. His critics, in any case, argued that the Soviet military was like a bear defending its home territory, capable of fending off an invader, but not of launching an offensive beyond its borders. It was the relative might of the two cross-channel neighbors that makes the relationship between their governments, and their spy services in particular, so integral to the story of the international effort to monitor and understand Hitler's Germany in the 1930s. Throughout this decade, this relationship was little more than a flirtatious liaison between two partners. The two partners began to embrace only suddenly in early 1939. And intimate though it latterly became, this relationship was at every stage riven by a state of mistrust and rivalry, characteristic of two countries that had been rivals and adversaries for centuries. Even in the spring of 1938, when Germany posed a strong threat, the French secret services were still closely monitoring the activities of a notoriously anti-French and very dangerous British intelligence agents, notably in North Africa, where they were judged guilty of secret collusion with Spanish nationalists against French interests. At the same time, numerous figures in the British cabinet, including the Prime Minister, Neville Chamberlain, wanted to avoid making a commitment to Paris. There was still time, they argued, for their policy of appeasement to satisfy Hitler's demands and avoid war. While the political relationship between Britain and France was central to the loose network of foreign spy agencies that watched the Reich, several other countries also played their part. In particular, there was also close contact between the French and the Czechs, who had signed a vaguely worded treaty of alliance and friendship in January 1924, and the Poles, who had also struck up a similarly worded alliance with Paris in 1921. Other countries also stood at the outer fringes of this loose network, including Holland, which, despite its supposed neutrality, gave underhand, low-level assistance to the British, as well as to the German intelligence services. Each of these countries had their respective spy services, whose relations both mirrored but also helped to shape those of their political masters. Sometimes these services pulled closer together because their governments were doing so, while at other times, like the tail wagging the dog, those governments were pushed closer together by the advent of some particularly startling piece of intelligence. Secret information about a resurgent Germany gradually brought the governments of Great Britain and France closer together in the course of the 1930s. In the words of Robert and Isabel Toombs, the Anglo-French relationship was forged by a German matchmaker all could agree to hate, while Peter Jackson writes that the volume of documentation concerning the importance of the Franco-British Entente in French diplomatic archives increases in direct proportion to the growth of German military power. As Hitler's demands became more assertive from 1936 and intelligence information more alarming, both governments orchestrated the same policy of appeasement that was designed at least to buy more time. And in the spring of 1939, a series of erroneous intelligence reports emanating from highly questionable sources prompted firstly Britain and then France to make a commitment to the defence of Poland that led both countries along a path to a conflagration that erupted 6 months later. Equally, the French government sometimes regarded closer links between its own spy service and the British as a precursor to a military alliance which would in turn create a political treaty. This made the British particularly wary of and resistant to any intelligence cooperation, which did not become intimate, constant, and systematic until the eve of the Second World War. There are other reasons why this international spy network presents a complex picture. One is that the relationships between all foreign governments were constantly evolving. When, for example, Paris signed a treaty of mutual assistance with Moscow in May 1935, relations cooled between France and Poland, which had highly acrimonious relations with the Soviets. And after the Munich Agreement, which was seen in Prague as a sellout by a French ally that had sworn, 14 years before, to provide aid and assistance, so too did the Czech intelligence services move away from their French counterparts and become closer with the British. Sometimes, too, the relations between the British and French spy services proved to be as choppy and unpredictable as the waters of the English Channel. For example, there was a flurry of intelligence sharing between them in the late summer of 1938 that broke off in October and November before resuming again in December. Equally, this network was often entirely asymmetric because information did not flow equally, in a reciprocal manner, between any of these actors. Despite their shared fears of Germany, there was little or no contact but much ill feeling between Warsaw and Prague. The Poles made no secret of their loathing for the Czech government and wanted to seize pieces of Czech territory, notably the border town of Teschen, while the Czechs were also wary of links between Warsaw and the government of Hungary, with which they also had their own territorial disputes. Above all, other intelligence services nearly always shared far more information with their British counterparts than they received back. This was partly because in London, the sharing of classified information with any foreign government was strictly regulated by a ministerial committee. But its members knew that other countries needed the support of Great Britain more than the British, whose politicians and general public wanted to remain aloof from continental alliances after the calamities of the First World War, felt they needed them. France, by contrast, could not so easily afford the luxury of such choices, most obviously because it was confronted by a long border with Germany, rather than being protected by the relative sanctity of the Silver Sea. Above all, by the 20 miles of the English Channel. The SIS, which was often referred to throughout Europe as the Intelligence Service or British Intelligence, was also highly mistrustful of its Czech counterparts because of Prague's links with the Soviet Union, fearing that Moscow could exploit them to infiltrate its own ranks or compromise its own sources, even though it was, of course, more than willing to accept any information that the Czechs passed on. Such fears became more prevalent from June 1935, when President Beneš visited Moscow on a personally conducted tour, during which his enthusiasm for the Soviets rose to lyrical heights. But however complex, shifting, and asymmetric the relationships between them, these intelligence agencies all shared the same ends that brought them, in such a varied way, closer together. The central, basic function of every foreign intelligence agency is, of course, to predict and gauge external threats to the country it is entrusted to guard. As the historian of this subject, F.H. Hinsley, has written, intelligence is an activity that has to perform three functions. Information has to be acquired, it has to be analysed and interpreted, and it has to be put into the hands of those who use it. And from 1933, and to some extent before, the analysis and interpretation of information showed that the threat posed by Germany was growing fast. This involved making accurate assessments of the existing quality and quantity of Germany's armed forces, and predicting their future strength. Throughout the 1930s, this meant seeing through a Nazi cloak of deception. To begin with, Hitler used this cloak to hide the manic pace of his covert rearmament plans. But then, from the spring of 1935, he deployed it to cast a shadow, conjuring a terrifying but inflated, misleading image of German power in a bid to intimidate his critics and opponents. Of particular interest to all these foreign onlookers was the strength of Hitler's air force. By the 1930s, warplanes had acquired a far greater range and striking power, leading some contemporaries to credit them with the potential to deal a knockout blow against civilian targets. This image of an overwhelmingly powerful strategic air force, rather than one that tactically supported an army's advance on the ground, was the stuff of the nightmare visions that had originally been conjured by H.G. Wells in his 1908 work, The War in the Air, and subsequently gripped the imagination of senior figures such as the former Prime Minister A.J. Balfour, who declared that 300 French bombers could render London uninhabitable by delivering a continuous torrent of high explosives at the rate of 75 tons a day for an indefinite period. Far from being a flight of fancy, such fears had seemed to become a deadly reality during the First World War, when German warplanes thundered over British skies, and then during the Spanish Civil War, 1936-9, when the town of Guernica was devastated in the space of just hours, killing around 1,700 civilians. And when Mussolini's warplanes dropped gas bombs to quell local insurgents in Abyssinia in 1935, many people's fears were propelled sky high. Fearful that the bomber would always get through against air defences that had an unproven value, leading governmental figures such as the British diplomat Robert Vansittart argued that an enemy air force was the arm in which we are likely to be faced in the future with the most bitter armament race, a far more formidable danger than anything in the way of naval or military armaments. His peers in the Committee of Imperial Defence even anticipated 500,000 casualties in Britain in the first weeks of a conflict with Germany, taking a series of drastic precautionary steps that laid the foundations of the National Health Service. But accurately judging the true strength of Hitler's air force, like his other military resources, was a hugely demanding task. It posed questions not just about how many planes the Germans possessed, but about a wide variety of other issues. Foreign spy chiefs needed to know about the training and aptitude of the German pilots and how reliable and well-serviced their planes were. When those planes were in the air, how maneuverable were they? And how many planes and pilots did the Luftwaffe have in reserve? Assessing the rate at which the Germans would continue to build up their strength of their air force and of all their other armaments was equally daunting, since this depended on such factors as the availability of raw materials, notably oil and rubber, and of skilled labour. And in the offices of the Air Ministry in London, experts also furiously debated issues such as Germanic efficiency, which some claimed would exert a powerful brake on Germany's industrial output. Of course, predictions and forecasts of production were in any case never likely to be more than guesstimates, given such variable factors as periods of consolidation, shortages of raw materials, human exhaustion, and the strain on the wider economy. Spying on the Reich also involved making informed judgments about the attitudes, mindset, and opinions prevalent within Nazi Germany, such as the state of morale of its armed forces and the ambitions and temperament of the governing elite that made or influenced key decisions of policy. Above all, was Hitler determined to fight aggressive wars against foreign targets, or was he just an opportunist? Were his outpourings in Mein Kampf and his posthumously published second book those of a dreamer or a blueprint for conquest that he was determined to realize? Were Hitler and his cohorts, like Hermann Göring, really just rearming Germany at such a furious rate because such a program offered a quick fix to the scourge of mass unemployment, which had helped to bring them to power in 1933 and which had virtually disappeared by 1937? And did they, or did ordinary Germans, want Wehrfreiheit, military freedom, not as a means of waging aggressive wars of foreign conquest, but more as a sign of national pride, as many commentators, well-versed in German and Prussian history, argued? The views of the wider general public also mattered because public opinion does not percolate Herr Hitler's ears, but will still count, if not before, in the extremity of the trenches. But were ordinary Germans strongly influenced by Nazi propaganda, and how susceptible would they be to British radio broadcasts? These were questions of political intelligence that the British Foreign Office and its French counterpart, the Foreign Ministry in Paris, the Quai d'Orsay, tried to answer, although they also fell within the remit of their respective intelligence services because Germany was a strategic threat to both countries. The difficulties of making any such judgment were self-evident. The principal trouble, as the Foreign Secretary, the first Earl of Halifax, wrote during the Sudeten crisis in September 1938, remains that we cannot possibly tell, however much we may guess, what is going on inside the brains of the one man who matters. Even as relatively late as 1937, it was far from clear if Hitler wanted economic supremacy in continental Europe to acquire colonies in the developing world, or to unleash outright war. Some wondered if he would see Britain and France as the true threat to Germany, or else cut a deal with the West that would allow him to undertake Drang nach Osten, march to the East. But trying to make any assessment was immensely difficult when Hitler discussed his key decisions with only the smallest and most intimate of circles. Some observers wondered if even this was a false assumption. Hitler lives more and more in a practically hermetically sealed case, and no one seems even to know who his chief advisers are, wrote Sir Neville Henderson, the British ambassador in Berlin from 1937 until 1939. Possibly no one. As a result, observers were constantly groping in the dark. Sometimes, too, Hitler would reach a decision at either the last minute or at an unpredictable, even random moments, as his instincts dictated, while he would also frequently and very rapidly change his mind. Not even Herr Hitler's intimates, according to one of them, knew for certain if he would really risk a world war, as one SIS assessment judged at the end of 1938. His decision to march into the Rhineland in 1936, for example, was taken only 2 weeks before he gave the order. It is impossible to know anything for certain in a regime where all depends on the will of a single individual whom one does not see, lamented Henderson. When dealing with such incalculability, as a senior diplomat, Gladwin Jebb, called it, intelligence reports were likely to be speculative and of limited value. Or, as the British military attaché in Prague wrote, The factors involved are so multiple and complex that it is impossible to arrive at any reasonable conclusion. Foreign spy agencies were also confronted by a police state that quickly built a security apparatus of terrifying ruthlessness and efficiency. The German police not only had powers to make arbitrary arrests and indefinitely detain suspects, but did not flinch from carrying out brutal punishments that were unthinkable elsewhere in Western Europe. Political opponents were sometimes hacked to pieces with pickaxes, a fate that descended upon the conservative politician Gustav von Kahr during the Night of the Long Knives in 1934, while traitors were typically beheaded. And anyone deemed an enemy of the Reich could easily be dispatched to concentration camps, such as Dachau near Munich, that were described by one inmate as a veritable chamber of horrors run by sadistic maniacs, and where life was more brutal, more savage, more sadistically bloody than anything we had ever imagined. Soon, Germany's borders and its increasingly numerous military sites were also sealed and closely monitored. Not surprisingly, the task of finding well-placed and genuine informers and running those agents without being detected was difficult in the extreme. We needed the secrets of a country, as the head of the Czech spy service later wrote, where people spoke in whispers. The challenges of casting light on such an opaque enemy also had an unfortunate consequence, which provides an underlying sub-theme of this book. Desperate to obtain reliable information and unable to verify the material that they did acquire, some intelligence services and their governments were vulnerable to falling under the spell of charlatans who made unproven assertions about what was happening within Germany. As Jeb wrote in an SIS memorandum in March 1939, politicians are only too apt to let themselves be swayed by backstairs gossip and precipitated into decisions which they afterwards regret. In theory, of course, this did not happen. No agent's report is ever put forward unless he has been tested over a long period, and the reliability or otherwise of his reports proved beyond doubt. But in practice, it was often far from clear who really fell into this category. British officials were, of course, well aware of this danger. In July 1938, Chamberlain himself referred to unchecked reports from unofficial sources, but could not evade it. It is likely, for example, that the Polish spy Jerzy Sanowski, and perhaps the British informer and fixer William de Rop, fell into this category for some and perhaps all of the duration of their careers, since both were paid considerable sums of money by their respective spy masters in return for providing material whose value continues to remain, at best, unclear. Equally, it was tempting to unwittingly exaggerate the importance of the personal opinions and impressions of individuals who perhaps never claimed to know more than they actually did. When the celebrated American aviator Charles Lindbergh and the French air chief General Joseph Vuillemin visited German aircraft factories and aerodromes in the mid to late 1930s and described what they saw, their eyewitness accounts were in fact pie in the sky. But they were taken at face value by experts who viewed their superficial accounts without the skepticism that they merited. It is into this same category that private intelligence networks also fall. Throughout the 1930s, the dearth of accurate intelligence meant that the British and French governments and their respective spy services were more inclined to turn to such parallel agencies, which influential figures such as the diplomats Robert Vansittart and Lord Lloyd set up as they made their own, sometimes frantic efforts to monitor the Reich and to warn the outside world about what they found or thought they found. This was partly because official agencies were so short of cash, and partly too because of the desperate need for information about a rapidly growing threat. On the upside, these networks could sometimes offer hugely valuable information that might otherwise have been missed. Malcolm Christie, who put the Air Ministry in touch with a high-level informant in the Luftwaffe, provides one such example. But equally, there were occasions when these private spy services used unverified sources to make unverifiable claims that would not, in all likelihood, have progressed far if ventured within the offices of the British or any other professional espionage agency. This was true, for example, of the claims put forward in March 1939 by the journalist Ian Colvin, who was granted immediate access to key decision-makers in Whitehall at a crucial moment. Perhaps this shortcoming is what Sir Alexander Cadogan later referred to when, towards the end of his life, he reread his diary of the events of the late 1930s and described the impression of a number of amateurs fumbling about with insoluble problems. He doubtlessly had in mind amateurs at every level, not just those in the very highest office. But he made a more specific reference to the dangers of private networks in a memorandum written in early 1939, as rumours of German plans abounded. Our agents are, of course, bound to report rumours or items of information which come into their possession. They exercise a certain amount of discrimination themselves, but naturally do not take the responsibility of too much selection, and it is our job here to weigh up the information which we receive and try to draw more or less reasonable conclusions from it. This danger of dubious sources making unverifiable claims that are then given too much credit too soon has at least two unfortunate outcomes. One is a loss of credibility. Any source that produces bad and unreliable material quickly forfeits its reputation, or finds it impossible to win one. But this is most undesirable if the source is capable of producing, perhaps even sporadically and occasionally, valuable material in the future. In the spring of 1939, for example, senior British diplomats became increasingly sceptical about the value of well-connected German informants such as Dr. Karl Gödeler, who tries to curdle our blood by overstating his case, even though his contacts were impressive and the reports sometimes accurate. Even more unfortunate is a situation in which one unreliable source also tarnishes the reputation of others, even though they may be quite different and have no connection. As Sir Alexander Cadogan wrote, "Our sources of information have lately become so prolific and blood-curdling that I am beginning to regard them all with a degree of suspicion." The other obvious danger is that bad intelligence can easily bounce decision-makers into making poor decisions. Again, in the spring of 1939, the British and French governments made a rushed and very questionable commitment to defend Poland on the grounds of very dubious intelligence reports about an imminent German attack. It is hard not to be reminded of parallels from the contemporary age in which charlatans had credence and dossiers of intelligence were deliberately sexed up in a bid to seduce public opinion. These are important themes of a story that starts not in 1933, when Hitler became Chancellor of Germany, but much earlier, when a shattered and defeated nation gradually and secretly began to rearm. 1. Germany reawakens. Early in the morning of the 6th of October 1920, a walker in Forstenriede Park, outside Munich, was suddenly confronted by a shocking scene that made him stop and stare in disbelief, filling him with an overwhelming sense of revulsion. Hanging from a rope barely a dozen yards before him and swinging silently in the breeze was the lifeless body of a young woman. Stunned and sickened by what he saw, he nonetheless recovered his senses and walked closer. As he did so, he saw a note, writ large and strung around her neck. Its message was simple, crude, and shocking. "You bitch, you have betrayed your country. The Black Hand have delivered justice." Later that day, the local police found out that the victim, who was barely out of her teens, was a young Munich woman by the name of Marie Sandemeyer. The facts of her case were unfortunate. Some months before, she had been working as a domestic servant in the luxurious home of a Bavarian aristocrat. She had left suddenly, probably sacked for some minor indiscretion, and had then seen a poster in the street that offered a reward for information about hidden arms caches in Germany. Whether out of financial hardship or vindictiveness, she had then approached the police with details of what she knew or claimed to know. What happened after that was unclear, but someone, perhaps in the ranks of the police, hadn't liked what she was doing and had taken the law into their own hands. At around the same time, a number of other ordinary German civilians, all of whom had led seemingly innocent and innocuous lives, also died mysterious and violent deaths, often in or around Munich. Amongst them was a local waiter who had also threatened to tip off the authorities about another illegal cache of arms, and who may have demanded payment to buy his silence. Again, word got round, and he paid the heaviest possible price. He was shot several times in the head by an unknown assassin before his body was weighed down with heavy stones and dropped into the murky depths of the River Isar. Then, in March 1921, the body of Hans Hartung, a young German man, was found in a stream, while two other corpses were also found hanging in Forstenrieder Park. Their torsos also bore macabre messages that were similar in style and tone as the note that had proclaimed the fate of Miss Sundmeyer. "I am a rat who betrayed the fatherland," went one, in an unconvincing attempt to make the death look like suicide, "so I die by my own hand." This series of brutal murders later became known as the Femmergerichte killings. This was a reference to vigilante courts, prevalent in parts of medieval Germany, that were not run by the state, but instead organized by self-appointed judges. Not only had these courts passed sentence on their unfortunate victims, but their henchmen had also pinned notes with excoriating messages on the chests of those they executed. And now, all these centuries later, the same unpleasant practices had been revived in the near anarchic conditions of the Weimar Republic by a self-proclaimed Black Reichswehr. This was a mysterious network of violent German nationalists, expert in the dark arts, that had sympathizers and perhaps even an active leadership at the very heart of the German government. Very little was known to outsiders about this Black Reichswehr, a term that explains the reference to the Black Hand that wrote and carried out its macabre writ of execution on Miss Sundmeyer. In the Reichstag, the defense minister, Otto Gisler, once proclaimed that it was an act of treason to even mention it in public, let alone to ask searching questions. But there was no real doubt about its ultimate purpose. This secretive organization, comprising serving or former members of the German armed forces, was sworn to help Germany defy international agreements and to rearm itself after its shattering defeat in the First World War. Most of its victims, including those who had met their grisly end in Forstenrieder Park, had seemed to pose a threat to such plans. In fact, Gessler, Sundmeyer, and the 24 or so other victims of the Black Reichswehr were amongst the first victims of Germany's post-1918 rearmament. This was a process that began to unfold in the ruins, smoke, chaos, and bloodshed of a shattered nation, resolutely defeated in the First World War, and culminated, 2 decades later, in the outbreak of the Second. Their blooded, lifeless corpses were an unmistakable sign that in Germany there were fanatics prepared to kill anyone who obstructed their bid to reassert what they regarded as their country's rightful place in the world. And they were a stark reminder to various foreign intelligence agencies across Europe and beyond of how this defeated nation, although vanquished, could still cast aside its shackles and pose a clear threat to others. A deadly game of German deception and of foreign investigation and espionage, one that was to last throughout those 2 subsequent decades, had already begun. In this Cold War, whose stakes could hardly have been higher, one participant was represented by a succession of German politicians, senior officers and industrialists who, for a number of different reasons, wanted to rearm their homeland. Some of these individuals were motivated by professional pride or by a desire to defend their homeland from foreign attack. The Germans had crushed foreign invasions before, notably in the summer of 1914, when the Russian army had moved into East Prussia in the first few weeks of the Great War. But they could not be sure about doing so again, particularly if they were confronted by the nightmare scenario that had so haunted their predecessors, the prospect of simultaneous attack on 2 fronts. At the Second Battle of the Marne in 1914, German strategists warned the Russian offensive in the east had diverted their soldiers from a French assault in the west. Others, however, wanted to restore what they regarded as Germany's rightful place in the world, with the influence and territories it deserved. Only later, after Adolf Hitler's accession to power in Berlin in 1933, were such limited ambitions dwarfed by an orchestrated, murderous, and diabolical program of territorial conquest. On the opposing side were the foreign intelligence services of several surrounding countries which, after the turmoil of the First World War, harbored deep fears of a resurgent Germany. Amongst them were Romania, Yugoslavia, and the Soviet Union. But the most important, given their military and economic power, were the British and French, whose spy chiefs worked hard to monitor and to thwart the covert German efforts to rearm, and sometimes to warn their political masters about what was happening. Both countries feared Germany for good reason. Nearly 1.5 million French soldiers had died in the Great War, and in just one prolonged, agonizing encounter fought at Verdun in the course of 1916 against an enemy that had sworn to bleed France white, the French army had sacrificed around 160,000 men. In Paris, such fears went back to at least the mid-1860s, when Bismarck's Prussia started to win a series of stunning military victories that culminated in a humiliating defeat of France during the brief but decisive War of 1870-1 and the creation of the State of Germany. The French had subsequently felt overshadowed by their neighbour and haunted by fears of their own relative decline. Since the 1890s, Germany had boasted a more powerful economy and a substantially larger population, which was still growing at a time when France's own was diminishing. And French fears of another war against Germany, or indeed any adversary, were heightened by their traumatic experience of the political instability that frequently ensues after a major defeat in the field. In 1870, humiliation and surrender on the battlefield had been followed by revolution and carnage in the streets of Paris. The British had also lost heavily in the Great War, sacrificing around 750,000 in a war that very arguably bestowed no obvious benefits and whose justification had always been open to question. From the moment of victory in November 1918, the British were as determined as the French and other powers to introduce a peace settlement that would prevent such a catastrophe from ever happening again. A young British diplomat, Harold Nicholson, revealed these understandable but absurdly high hopes when he later described how we were preparing not peace only, but eternal peace. There was about us the halo of some divine mission. But the British pushed for a more lenient line than France against Germany, gripped as they were by fears of another nightmare becoming a terrifying reality. Winston Churchill, a junior minister in Lloyd George's cabinet, called this nightmare the plague bacillus of Bolshevism that had already infected Russia and brought down the Tsar in the revolution in 1917. Now, like a deadly virus, it seemed ready to sweep west into Germany and beyond, and such a threat needed to be locked down only with compromise and conciliation, not by threats. On the 28th of June 1919, 7 months after the ceasefire, large crowds gathered outside the vast Palace of Versailles near Paris to watch the arrival of the great names of the day, including President Woodrow Wilson, the British leader David Lloyd George, and the French Prime Minister Georges Clemenceau, who then signed a treaty that would, its advocates hoped, consign the last conflict as the war to end wars. But in the words of one diplomat who witnessed the grandiose proceedings, it was the utmost insult to Germany, one that was always likely to stir up a resentment, bitterness, and feelings of vengeance within the defeated nation. In the Great Hall of Mirrors, where the delegates signed their treaty, they had seen reflections of their own emotions rather than the true state of Germany. This was partly, perhaps largely, because the French took a harshly vindictive line, pushing for draconian measures against a defeated adversary. These feelings also merged with economic jealousy and insecurity, and perhaps with fears that the French nation had lost its old fighting spirit and would in the future be unable to defend itself. Powerful waves of pacifist sentiment were at this time sweeping through the country, prompting Churchill to claim that France was armed to the teeth but pacifist to the core, and forcing cadets at the military academy of Saint-Cyr to wear only civilian dress when they went outside for fear of provoking abuse or even assaults by members of the public. And on the streets outside Versailles, French pacifists attacked the German delegation on their arrival, pelting them with rotten fruit and other missiles. But while London urged moderation, fearing a nationalist reaction that would play into the hands of German communists, Clemenceau showed little clemency and insisted that the Treaty of Versailles should impose massive financial reparations and tear whole strips of territory away from the vanquished state. Chief amongst these was the creation of an unnatural corridor of Polish territory in what had previously been East Prussia. This gave the newly formed state of Poland access to the sea, but nonetheless drove a wedge between East Prussia and the rest of Germany. It was always an issue that looked likely to start a future conflict. In addition, the French reclaimed Alsace and Lorraine, while the treaty also gave them two German territories for the next 15 years, the coal-producing region of the Saarland and the Rhineland, which became a neutral, demilitarized zone. But because the armed forces unmistakably represented their country's greatness, as well as being the most obvious guarantee of their self-defense, the disarmament clauses of the Versailles Treaty were amongst those that caused the most indignation for many Germans. These imposed severe restrictions upon the number of soldiers, just 100,000, that Germany was now allowed to have. To prevent any reserves being built, officers were also required to serve for 25 years and ordinary soldiers for 12. The Germans were also prohibited from producing any new arms and forced to destroy any stockpiles of arms or else surrender them to the Allied forces. Similarly, harsh conditions were imposed on Germany's navy, while its air force was outlawed altogether. The French also wanted other guarantees of their national security, notably a defensive alliance with Great Britain. The government's great fear, as the Prime Minister Edouard Herriot later told his generals, was that one day France would find herself alone facing Germany. Such an alliance represented a great prize. Britain's immense financial power had enabled it to raise American loans that subsidized the entire Allied war effort and bucked up morale during the First World War. And because the immense might of the Royal Navy had kept this war effort afloat, British support was vital in the event of any future conflict. In the Great War, the British fleet had contained the German Navy, guarded merchant shipping, and blockaded the Axis powers. In any future conflict, it would allow France to concentrate on controlling the Mediterranean, which provided a vital artery to its colonial territories in North Africa and beyond. With its navy, its military potential, its immense economic resources, and especially its fidelity to engagements, observed the French ambassador in London in early 1922, Britain is as precious an ally in wartime as its political influence, moral authority, and loyalty make it in peacetime. The French had craved an alliance with Great Britain long before the First World War. In 1904, the two countries had promised to resolve some of their differences, but French diplomats wanted to convert this entente cordiale into a formal alliance. Their own mistrust of the British, of perfidious Albion, was outweighed by their fear and suspicion of Germany, nor did such fears of their eastern neighbour abate after 1918. For Georges Clemenceau, this meant that an understanding with Great Britain was the essential basis of his foreign policy. He would not and could not help the Poles in the event of a German attack, he told them, unless the British first helped him. Clemenceau even offered to build and pay for the construction of a channel tunnel that would allow a British expeditionary force to come to the defence of France within just hours. Only with the help of John Bull, his powerful navy, his burgeoning modern air force, and his immense imperial resources, as Piers Brendan puts it, could Marianne survive a prolonged Teutonic assault. But now, as before, John Bull rebuffed Marianne's advances. After the horrors of the Great War, isolationist sentiment was strong in London. There seemed to be no compelling reason to tie a knot that would drag Britain to the altar of another, perhaps quite unnecessary, war on the continent. In London, maintaining a balance of power across the Channel would not help Britain to defend her empire, but could instead easily distract and divert its resources from those more vital interests. This was set to become all the more important a consideration after 1931, when Imperial Japan presented a rapidly growing threat to the security of British India and Australia. And any such further entanglements would also be likely to prove very expensive, imposing more costs on war-weary British taxpayers at a time when their vast empire was already burdensome. As the Prime Minister Neville Chamberlain was to lament a few years later, "If only it wasn't for Germany, we would be having such a wonderful time just now. What a frightful bill do we owe to Master Hitler, damn him." France needed Britain, in other words, more than the British needed the French. As an island power, the British did not share the same sense of vulnerability that had long afflicted their neighbours. If the British were deeply wary of any continental alliances, they were even more mistrustful of striking one with France. This reflected long centuries of rivalry and war that had woven stories of Joan of Arc and Agincourt, Napoleon and Trafalgar, the Norman conquest, and of British success and French humiliation at Fashoda in East Africa, deep into the national tapestries of both countries. Despite moments of cooperation, such as those of the Crimean War, and some close personal friendships amongst rulers and political elites, relations were typically deeply ambivalent between two countries that became allies only after the onset of the Great War in August 1914. These sentiments of rivalry and suspicion were mutual. People in this country forget all too easily that there are just as many Anglophobes in France as there are Francophobes in England. Indeed, perhaps there are more, as Robert van der Tart wrote. Such mistrust between London and Paris persisted throughout the First World War and beyond. Despite their united front against a common enemy, the Great War had aggravated rather than healed the animosity that many British people felt for their continental neighbour. Anti-French feeling among ex-soldiers amounted almost to an obsession, wrote the celebrated war poet Robert Graves, while one British aristocrat echoed the views of many of his fellow soldiers when he exclaimed that, "If another war comes, I hope the partners will be changed." Clemenceau's uncompromising line at Versailles stirred up even more anti-French feeling, even amongst Francophiles like Sir Austen Chamberlain and Winston Churchill, who were shocked by the harsh French approach. Other post-war incidents reinforced such views. During the Chanak crisis of September 1922, for example, the French had infuriated London by pulling their troops out of disputed territories in the Ottoman Empire, leaving British soldiers exposed and isolated. There could scarcely have been any better way of entrenching the anti-French prejudices of figures such as Sir Maurice Hankey, who regarded the French as duplicitous and unreliable, and of the Foreign Secretary, Lord Curzon, who lamented that the great power from whom we most have to fear in the future is France. At almost the same time, the British Air Staff felt that the prospect of war with France was the greatest menace to this country. Britain and France, in other words, were most dear enemies that had been superficially allied in war, but now continued to be profoundly divided in peace. Nor did such British suspicions of France abate throughout the 1920s. The Locarno Treaty, signed in 1925 by leaders of Western European countries who agreed amongst themselves to respect their existing borders, was seen as a means of protecting Germany against France, at least as much as anything else. In the eyes of David Lloyd George, for example, the French were striving to acquire hegemony in Western Europe and trying to rope in Britain behind. The French, however, were wise to be so concerned about their security, for while the remnants of the German army sometimes provoked ridicule from foreign observers, on occasion by using fake tanks made of wood, canvas, and cardboard on parades and on exercises, Berlin was in fact making a determined effort to rearm almost as soon as the Treaty of Versailles had been signed, and perhaps even before. Some of this covert gun running was driven purely by profit. Some destitute employees in the arms industry and elsewhere were prepared to sell secrets to anyone who offered generous bribes. In 1921, for example, the French Foreign Spy Service, the Deuxième Bureau, offered significant sums to several employees of a German company that was developing blueprints of a new aircraft that the French agents were particularly keen to see. The designs were smuggled out of the factory and taken, hidden inside a suitcase, to a hotel rendezvous with undercover French operatives. Another such renegade was not a German national, but a Dutchman. The fortunes of Antony Fokker, aged just 28 at the end of the Great War, had risen sky-high when he developed and then manufactured several highly successful types of aircraft. Just months after the Versailles Treaty came into force, and as the inspectors started to home in on his factories, he smuggled the bulk of his personal savings onto foreign soil, hiding these vast cash sums in suitcases that were then moved out of Germany, firstly on a boat and then, subsequently, by train. Within just a few weeks, Fokker had spirited his planes, 400 engines, and a great deal of other material into neutral Holland. But if Fokker's actions were motivated more by profit and careerism, many others were concerned with the grandeur of their homeland. As some foreign observers noticed, in Germany the status of the army was indistinguishable from feelings of national pride. The other chief consideration was, of course, the national security of a country that was threatened on both its eastern and western fronts. Such fears were felt most deeply by the acting head of the German army, General Hans Friedrich von Siegt, who was dismayed by Germany's defeat and surrender in 1918, and regarded the Versailles Treaty as a poison that was capable of killing Germany spiritually as well as militarily. He and his fellow generals were now determined to hide Germany's covert rearmament from the watching eye of the victorious Allies, who had set up an international body for that very purpose. Britain and France liaised closely as they watched and monitored a defeated Germany, but this was not an interaction between their respective intelligence services, whose eyes were focused more on events in Russia and the apparent threat posed by communism. It was instead undertaken by the Inter-Allied Military Commission of Control, IMCC, that the Treaty of Versailles had set up to ensure the complete execution of its disarmament clauses. Headquartered at the impressive Hotel Adlon in central Berlin, The commission was run by 9 senior Allied officers, 4 of whom were French and 2 British. They organized and supervised inspections by their officials, who were scattered all over the defeated nation and who had immense freedom to travel to any point whatever in German territory and inspect whatever and whenever they thought fit. These inspectors pooled their information but also shared their findings with their respective governments and intelligence services, who were entrusted with assessing the information that they received and bringing their conclusions to the attention of their political masters. The inspectors initially notched up an impressive balance sheet of information, and it looked as though their surveillance of post-war Germany was reaping handsome dividends. By the early 1920s, they had visited thousands of sites, supervised the dynamiting of entire infrastructure, and disabled many more specialized industrial tools and machinery, which had sustained the German war effort for 4 long years. During one particularly energetic 6-week period alone, between September and October 1924, they carried out more than 200 inspections at factories that had manufactured vast quantities of arms throughout the war. And at Essen in the Ruhr, the site of the vast industrial conglomerate that the Krupp family had built up over decades, several inspectors set up a permanent residence at a guest house, using it as a base from which to make snap inspections and to interview visiting businessmen and factory officials. But although they were unaware of it, they were often chasing shadows. They spent considerable amounts of time inspecting facilities whose bosses had been illicitly tipped off, and at other times were deliberately fed with false leads. On one occasion, they made a long and fruitless journey to investigate a fallacious story about a factory whose prams could somehow be reassembled into machine guns. In truth, some arms were built surreptitiously in workshops away from main factories, and then hidden on heathland or in sand dunes. Behind a facade of cooperation with the Allies, German factory owners and operatives often tried to circumvent the rules, padlocks, milk cans, cash registers, rail mending machines, refuse carts and similar rubbish appeared really innocent, and locomotives and motorcars appeared perfectly peaceful, as the arms magnate Gustav Krupp wrote afterwards. Industrialists became particularly expert in the arts of deception, for example, by spreading out equipment in an exaggerated manner, as the inspectors themselves noted, to make their workshops look sparser than they really were. By the mid-1920s, an increasing number of German industrialists and commanders were also following the example of Antoni Fokker by offshoring their enterprises. This was true of Gustav Krupp, who deeply resented a treaty designed to keep the German people enslaved forever. Looking abroad to find places to store, research and develop arms, he made good use of an old machinery plant, once run by EB Landswerk, at Landskrona in southern Sweden, and also bought shipbuilding yards in Rotterdam, where he set up a special centre for ordnance manufacture that was staffed by German experts from the major naval base at Kiel. He also established a number of other such companies at Barcelona, Bilbao and Cadiz, where U-boats were now built and tested. The German authorities also proved duplicitous. It was no coincidence that, just as the Germans began to act against both the spirit and the letter of the Versailles Treaty on such a scale, they also started to show some superficial cooperation with the Allied inspectors. There has been a marked improvement in general attitude by the Germans, who have changed their attitude very considerably in the last month, wrote a delighted Colonel McGrath of the IMCC's Berlin office in March 1925. This was partly because there was strong international pressure on Germany to comply with its obligations, for in February 1925, the IMCC had issued a general report that called on Berlin to make a greater effort and concluded that a strenuous effort was needed to enforce the Versailles Treaty. But the Germans also wanted to drive wedges between the Allies. Such divisions existed within the ranks of the IMCC, in which hardliners like Morgan and its French director Charles Nollet took issue with the more moderate and trusting approach of colleagues such as General Sir Francis Bingham. But the rift they really wanted to exploit lay between the French and the more moderate British. In the early 1920s, Paris continued to take the most hawkish line, even pushing for more direct Allied control over Germany, rather than supervising the efforts of the German government to enforce the terms of the treaty. Such demands had prompted Viscount d'Abernon, the British ambassador in Berlin, to write that, "I consider the French demand for the total disarmament of all Einwohnerwehr, Citizens' Defense, and similar organizations almost insane. The French do not appear to understand that the real danger is communist disorder. A respectable German army, ran the British argument, would not only be in a position to crush any communist revolt, but would also give a degree of national pride that would stop the country falling into the hands of extremists. But these Anglo-French differences became more pronounced from March 1926, when the Germans had applied for admission to the League of Nations, while also demanding that all international inspections and controls should be swept away. Germany had respected the demands of the Versailles Treaty, argued Berlin fallaciously, and the inspectors had served their purpose and should now leave. The French immediately resisted these calls and compiled a long and detailed dossier of German violations of the treaty. Berlin was massaging its figures, Paris claimed, akin to squeezing a heavyweight into a corset. It was really maintaining an enormous number of NCOs and generals while also organizing illegal paramilitaries, hiding forbidden weapons, and concealing its growing links with Russia. Germany, the French argued, has not shown good faith in carrying out her obligations, and there are still a number of important points covered by the time limit clauses which remain to be fulfilled. At the same time, Paris insisted on maintaining Allied troops in the Rhineland and still worked hard, without success, to lure Britain into a formal defensive alliance. The importance of British support had become particularly clear in 1923 when the French government had retaliated against Berlin's failure to pay some of the reparations imposed by the 1919 treaty by sending troops into the Ruhr district in a bid to seize control over its valuable resources. But the subsequent international furor forced the French to beat a retreat and reminded them that they needed British diplomatic as well as military support. But there was no sea change of opinion across the Channel, and still London refused an alliance with its old enemy. Critics argued that it would be viewed in Berlin as a potential threat and risked inflaming nationalist sentiment playing into communist hands. Instead, the British government wanted to bring an immediate end to the inspections, arguing that they stifled a spirit of reconciliation that would heal divisions and prevent another tragedy comparable to the First World War. But in December 1926, deeply alarmed at the possibility that Germany might soon be freed from Allied military control, the French War Ministry produced another alarming report, warning that Germany was far more dangerous than recognized. Citing evidence of hidden stockpiles of arms, it estimated that Germany could call up more than 6 million men and 500,000 officers and NCOs, while also raising 120 to 150 divisions of frontline troops. In fact, such claims were a desperate attempt to keep the inspectors in Germany, and the French Foreign Ministry disputed them. To the alarm and horror of Paris, it was the British line that won the day when, on the 31st of January 1927, the IMCC formally pulled out of its Berlin headquarters and ended its eight-year presence in Germany. Military control over the country now passed to the League of Nations, and no foreign government or agency had any automatic legal right to investigate German military affairs beyond the Rhineland, where both countries continued to station troops. By this date, the War Office in London stated proudly, the numbers, organization, and equipment of the German army had, broadly speaking, been brought into conformity with the provisions of the Treaty of Versailles. But privately, many of those who were familiar with events in Germany were furious, claiming that the British government had been far too quick to overlook overwhelming evidence of German rearmament. There was by this time another, more specific reason why some foreign observers were feeling a sense of alarm about German affairs. This was the sudden, spectacular rise of a young Austrian fanatic called Adolf Hitler, whose National Socialist movement was attracting an increasing number of followers, particularly in and around the politically turbulent city of Munich. It was to find out more about this nationalist firebrand that the young Truman Smith, acting as an assistant US Army attaché, had been tasked in 1922. Travelling through Bavaria, Smith had noted how the National Socialists are increasing their strength rapidly. Hitler was, in his view, a pure and simple adventurer, but a real character who was exploiting all latent discontent to increase his party's strength. The threat he posed was greater because he thoroughly understands the Bavarian psychology. Smith, like others, could see and sense that trouble was brewing. 2. Foreign spies keep watch. As the last of the international inspectors left Germany, they passed the mantle of intelligence gathering to their respective spying agencies, who were now entrusted with the task of monitoring developments within Germany's borders and gauging the potential threat that they posed. It was upon the British and French that the burden now fell. The United States did not maintain any full-time intelligence presence on German soil, and instead only posted serving diplomats and attachés at its embassy in Berlin, all of whom lacked specialist training in espionage. The Czech spy services were at this stage run by just a handful of military officers, whose attention was focused largely on the much more immediate threat of a Polish attack on disputed territories, whilst also suffering from an outdated preoccupation with Austria and its Habsburg restoration. And Moscow's gaze was too distracted by the bloody political turmoil at home to focus on potential threats that might, in a worst-case scenario and at some distant future point, perhaps eventually materialize. During the Great War, the SIS and the Bureau had worked closely together, even setting up a joint command, based in Folkestone in Kent, that was focused on tracking and neutralizing German agents who were operating on Allied soil. But even at these moments of greatest danger, such shared challenges could not create more than a superficial unity between two countries, whose relations had for centuries been characterized by outright enmity, rivalry, suspicion, and jealousy. Such mistrust lingered after the armistice. Both services, it is true, continued to work together on matters of mutual concern, such as monitoring Bolshevik agents on Western soil and Japanese espionage on the British fleet in the English Channel, which in 1925 was the subject of correspondence between two heads of department, Colonels Stewart and Henry Laney. And from the mid-1920s, the SIS also ran a number of stations in France that tracked Soviet agents and sympathizers, making use of Paris-based émigrés to obtain information about what was happening within Russia. This was done with the full knowledge and at times the full cooperation of the French authorities. But the wider picture revealed an image of rivalry or even open competition for influence in several other parts of the world. This became particularly clear soon after the signing of the Versailles Treaty, when the head of the Deuxième Bureau, Colonel Charles Fournier, had written a telling memorandum that bore a revealing testimony. Now that the war had ended, he argued, the exchange of confidential information with Great Britain was no longer necessary and would even have a serious downside. Henceforth, he continued, information should only be shared if it concerned an historic issue rather than one that gives an assessment of our present or future capabilities. Any such exchange of information would also have to go through the proper channels and through the military attachés who were stationed at the respective embassies in foreign capitals. And although they were working together to supervise post-war Germany, the two countries also kept a close and wary eye on each other's activities. In July 1927, for example, a suspicious military attaché at the French embassy in Berlin picked up signs that the British were establishing relations cordiales with the German army. Such games of rivalry were played out, above all in the Netherlands, where the French reported that the SIS was using banking and commercial operations to hide its activities, and suspected that it was also seeking to penetrate the Deuxième Bureau's local intelligence networks and buy off its agents. So strong were French suspicions of British intelligence activities in the Low Countries, particularly of the SIS heads of station in Rotterdam, Captain Richard Tinsley and Major Hugh Dalton, that Colonel Laney set up an inquiry into the matter. And in North Africa, the Bureau shadowed suspected SIS operatives such as H.R. Owen and the enigmatic Guy Loftus, whose meetings with Major Fox, the British consul at Bizerte, and an undoubted British agent, aroused great suspicion of an Anglo-Saxon plot against French interests. Given the wide channel between them, it was not surprising that the two spying agencies missed crucial information about the state of a German army that seems to have disappeared from public view in a way that arouses suspicion. In April 1926, the Army General Staff in Berlin had issued a directive for planning what became known as the First Armaments Program, one that would start the following year and finish in 1932. Its estimates were based on a threefold, or even ninefold, increase above their supposed level, yet neither the SIS nor the Bureau appeared to have been aware of this order. But their independent efforts had some success at detecting Germany's covert rearmament outside its borders. Holland was a particular concern, not least because its economy was so closely integrated into Germany's industrial heartland, and French agents kept a very close eye on two businesses that were based in Amsterdam. One was Rodius Koenigs, an import-export business that was suspected of having undercover links with both Krupp and Siemens, and the other was IPU, a German-owned press agency run by Peter Kierner that was seen as a cover for German intelligence. In 1925, the Bureau had three agents in its Dutch network who were focused on the comings and goings at Fokker's factories, as well as another two operatives who concentrated on researching military intelligence about Germany. These agents were tasked with obtaining solid information about the German military, in addition to other duties that included monitoring arms trafficking to North Africa and tracking both communist and German influence in and infiltration of Holland and elsewhere. The British also began to watch Kierner, whose activities became the subject of Anglo-French correspondence in the mid-1920s, and the two agencies discovered that his press agency was running German...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.